I, Joita Jaki, on behalf of JECARE, the Social Responsibility Committee, welcome you all to the second session of Mindful Moment series, How to Connect with the Divine. And today, we are going to focus on this. In the first session, Anjali ma'am enlightened us by telling about who am I, and we should all know the answer of this question, as from there, we can nurture ourselves more. Now, I would request ma'am to take the session forward. Ma'am, please.
Before we begin, let us start with a 30-second silence in which we invite the Divine to hear, to speak, and to help us understand whatever we are speaking or hearing. Let us just invite the Divine. After the last session, we came to one conclusion. In essence, we are the soul. That soul which was in our past birth, that soul which is continuing in this birth and which will continue into our future births. Swami Vivekananda once said, within each one of you, there is the power to remove all wants and miseries. Believe in this, and that power will be manifested. He also said, Ishvara is the Atman as seen or grasped by the mind. Now, today's session is going to focus on what comes obviously as the next question, that how do we connect? How does my outer being, my body, my emotional being, my mental being, all these three envelopes that, all the three coverings that there are to the soul, how do we connect this outer being to the inner being? How do we find ourselves? Because this is clear that I am the soul. Now, if I am the soul, how do I find the soul? How do I find myself? You know what? We are not a 100-rupee note in last year winter coat pocket. No, we are not lost. Our true self, our soul, is right here within us, but it is buried. It is buried under what? It is buried under our cultural conditionings. It is buried under our opinions. It is buried under our inaccurate conclusions. It is buried under the education that I have received since I was a child. Hardly anybody's parents have told him since he was a child that, my child, you are this Atman. How many schools have made this a part of their education to educate their child, educate their student, and let him know his real self. Let him get acquainted to his real self. Let him learn how to connect this outer being with this inner being, which is continuing from birth to birth to birth. So we are buried under the weight of the education that we have received. And because of all these coverings to the soul, we have started believing that we are limited human beings. Now, finding ourselves is actually like a homecoming. It is actually like returning back to ourselves. It is like an unlearning. You unlearn what you have learned all this while. It is like an excavation. It is a discovery that one makes. It is actually remembering again who we were before the world and our education got its hands on us. Now, one would think, Baba, ye to bada mushkil rasta hai. Isme to badi mehnat karni padegi. That this journey is going to be really difficult. Finding ourselves or finding the soul will require hours and hours of meditation, and it will require so much mantra chanting and so much of all this mumbo jumbo. On the contrary, my dear students and my dear faculty, I would like to tell you that to connect with oneself, to connect with the soul within, is one of the simplest processes of our life, even simpler than choosing what to eat. It's simpler than that. And who has made it simple? Krishna has made it simple in the Bhagavad Gita. Sri Aurobindo has made it simple by explaining in simple terms what Sri Krishna has said. But before we begin on this journey of excavation, of journey, before we begin this journey of exploration, I would like to tell you a story. A story of a guru and a disciple. Once a person went to a master and said, "Sir, pranam to you. Can you please give me a mantra or any method by which we can realize God? I want to realize God. I want to find him within myself. I want to be able to connect with the soul inside. And not only connect, I want to be stationed there." So the master closed his eyes. And he said, "Remember this simple mantra from the Upanishads. What is the mantra? Tat Tvam Asi. Tat means that. Tvam, thou. Asi, art. You are that. You are the divine. The entire potentiality of the divine resides within you as your soul. Purnamada Purnamidam. Purnat Purnamudachyate. Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vishishyate." The disciple didn't believe the master. Why? Because he felt this method is too simple. So he said, "I don't like this master. He's trying to make it very simple and it is not possible." So he went to another master and he asked the same question. And the second master, these masters are all connected. When you're connected to your soul, you're connected to the entire universe. This master knew what had happened with this disciple and the earlier master. So this master, the second guru, gave him work. He said, "Look, you do work in this ashram. 8 hours of work and at least 4 hours of meditation. And this you have to do for 12 years. After which I will give you that magic mantra." And he was supposed to look after the gardens in the ashram, do planting, look after the cow shed, milk the cows, clean the ashram, cook the food. And after that, he was supposed to sit in a certain kind of meditation with a technique that was taught by the master. And the student, because he was a very, very conscientious student whose aspiration to connect inside was so burning and so sincere, he did everything that he was told religiously, waiting every day of the 12 years for that mantra that his new guru would give to him. After 12 years were over, he went to his guru and he said, "12 years are over today, sir. Pranam Guruji, aaj mujhe wo mantra de dijiye. Give me that mantra by which I will be able to connect with the soul inside." And the guru gave him his mantra. And guess what the mantra was? Tat Tvam Asi. That thou art. So the master said to him that your master, your first master, your first guru had already shared this mantra with you. He had already given the mantra to you. The mantra was anyway doing its work inside you. But you didn't trust him because you felt that the road to finding the soul, the road to connecting with the soul, the road to realizing the soul cannot be so simple. And you wanted a difficult road because you didn't believe that this road can be so simple. And today I tell you, my dear child, that the real truth can be as simple, as straight, as direct as this. That the method of connecting with the divine is so simple. It doesn't have to be a very difficult process. Most truths of life, my dear students, my dear faculty, most truths of life are simple. So, what are we going to do today? Today, we are looking for a simple method which helps us in connecting our outer being with our soul, our true self. Today, we are here to learn how to connect with God. Let's take a simple, very, very simple. Now, suppose we meet someone, a stranger, and we like that person. What do we wish? We instantly wish that I'd like to be in touch with that person. And we try to get his or her cell number. And we start with sending simple SMSs, maybe a good morning, maybe a joke, maybe a forward. And then we wait. That does that person also want to be connected to me? Does that person also want to become my friend? And only when we are sure of his or her response, we may even try to invite that friend over for a coffee or a meal to make our bonding stronger and stronger. It is a little tough in the beginning, but it is not so difficult, is it? But believe it or not, my dear students, it is even simpler to connect with God. Even simpler. Do you know why? Because with a friend, we are waiting for his or her approval. But with God, we don't have to wait for his approval. He has given us a blanket approval to each one of us. In fact, he is actually waiting for us to call him our friend. And he has waited so long. He has waited since the day we were born, as whatever form we are born in. So, if he is waiting to connect with us, and we are aspiring to connect with him, what is the next step that we need to take? To connect with anybody, we need to know their address, or at least their phone number. Let us try and find the divine. Where is the divine? And we will go in that process, which Aurobindo has said, we will go from near to far. God is within us. And this we've already discussed in the first session. He is within us as that perfect soul. Purnamada, Purnamidam. He's the Purna, he's the perfect. God is all around us. God has expanded himself. He gave you the mantra from the Mundaka Upanishad, how the Rishi says that the divine says, just like a spider takes the web out of his own being, this whole universe, I have taken out of my own being. I have expanded myself and become this universe. So this table, this glass of water, every circumstance, everything around us is the divine himself. And third, God is above us as the Lord and Master. Let us study each of these a little more closely with, like last time, Aapta Vakya Praman. Aapta, a realized person, Vakya, his utterings, Pramana, his testimony. When a realized being says something, utters something, it becomes a living testimony for us. So with Aapta Vakya Praman, we will go through these three statuses of the divine. God within us, God around us, and God above us. God is within us. And Shri Krishna says to Arjuna in the 18th chapter, verse 61, Ishvarah sarvabhutanam hriddeshe Arjuna tishthati. The Lord, O Arjuna, is seated in the heart of all existences. He resides in us as our soul. God is all around us, for he has become the universe. The divine has become the entire universe. He has not created it. This universe is not like a painting that an artist has created and the artist is separated from the painting. No. The divine has become the universe. Every part of this universe is the divine himself. Every animate and inanimate being is him. The trees, the plants, the animals, the birds, the air we breathe, the rain that comes, even the drought that comes, that we suffer, all are him. All circumstances of life are him. He says in the Bhagavad Gita that just as the spider weaves the web out of himself, I weave the universe out of myself. I become the universe. Vasudeva sarvam iti sa mahatma sudurlabha. Very rare is the great soul who knows that Vasudeva, the omnipresent being, is all that is. Bhagavad Gita, 7th chapter, 19th verse. Very rare is the great soul who knows that Vasudeva, the omnipresent being, is all that is. We must remember that if we believe in Krishna, it is Vasudeva. If we believe in Christ, you can just substitute Vasudeva for Christ. If we are believing in Allah, substitute the word Vasudeva for Allah. It doesn't matter what form we want to worship him in, what form we want to look at him as. All is him. We are only not tuned yet to experience him in all. There have been and there are still saints and sages till today who are living in this cosmic consciousness. They can experience him in all. And when we experience him everywhere, jab hum experience karte hain unko har jagah, tab even dharti maa pe jab hum charan rakhte hain to hame dharti maa ki pukar sunti hai. And dharti maa shakti ko bula rahi hai. Hey maa tujhe pranam, hey maa tujhe pranam. This is the kind of experience we can have when we become a little more subtle, a little more sensitive to the presence of the divine in all. Then we would be able to, when we see the air that's blowing, we would be able to hear the prayer of the air. Vayu ka mantra gaan sunai dega. Wo vayu jo keh rahi hai, jo ga rahi hai. Hey, anandamai chaitanyamai. Satyamayi Parme. When we see the leaves fluttering with the wind, we see the prayer of the air and the prayer of the leaves together. He Anandamayi Chaitanyamayi Satyamayi Parme. When we are connected with God in all, we experience the call of the trees, the call of the plants to God. My teacher, Kirit Uncle, used to say that trees are always, plants are always in a state of prayer. They're always upwards, looking towards the light and in a state of prayer. That is why many environmentalists also tell us that when you feel down or depressed or a lack of energy, just go and hug a tree. Hug a tree and see what a difference it makes to your being. Because in Viksho mein, ek urdhva gamini prarthana rehti hai, always aspiring for the divine. And we would be able to listen to that. This is about God is everywhere. Now let us look at God who is above us as the Lord and Master controlling the universe. God is above us as the Lord and Master controlling the universe. This is his third status. First status is God is within us. Second status, simultaneously, is that God is all around us. And the third status, which is also simultaneously, God is above us as the Lord and Master controlling the universe. So in the Bhagavad Gita, 4th chapter, 6th verse, Shri Krishna says to Arjuna, Ajopi sannavyayatma Bhutanam Ishwaropi San. I am the unborn. I am the imperishable in my self-existence. I am the Lord of all existences. In chapter 9, he says, Aham hi sarva yajnanam bhokta cha prabhureva cha. It is I myself who am the enjoyer and the Lord of all sacrifices. When he uses the word sacrifices, we can always substitute it for all offerings. All offerings that are made by us in our anjali and offered to the divine. So it is myself who am the enjoyer and the Lord of all offerings. Now tell me, students and faculty, which status of God is the easiest to connect with? One is so close to us, right here, within us. Kasturi kundal base mrig dhunde van mahi, aise ghati ghati ram hai, duniya dekhat nahi. One is all around us, but in myriads of forms. And one is above us and hardly visible. The easiest to connect with your students is connecting with him within us, right? The divine is that luminous light within. I am that luminous light within. I am the soul, the Atma, the Ruh, which was, which is, and which shall be. Now let us just for 30 seconds try and connect with this white flame inside of us. You know what? Sri Krishna tells Arjuna in chapter 9, verse 27, the secret of how to connect with. This is a very, very important verse of the Bhagavad Gita. Yat karoshi yadashnasi, yat juhoshi tadasi yat. Yat tapasyasi konteya, tat kurushva madarpanam. O Arjuna, whatever thou doest, whatever thou enjoyest, whatever thou sacrificest or offers to me, whatever thou givest, whatever energy of tapasya, of the soul's will or effort thou puttest forth, make it an offering unto me. So what a big secret Sri Krishna has given to Arjuna. My dear students, we learn from these words of Krishna that he's saying that whenever you want to connect with me, all you need to do is offer whatever you are doing, to me. And it doesn't take more than 2 seconds. Whether you are having food. Now, 2 seconds, if you close your eyes and say, Krishna, Allah, Christ, whatever, I invite thee into this food. I offer this food to thee. Let thy will be done. Let this food do to me what is your will for it. And what has happened? The food turns into a prasada. You're having a glass of water. 1 second, you offer this water to him, invite him into the water. The water turns into a prasada. You're preparing for an examination. Now tell me, there is one way of preparing, which is preparing from my mind, and another in which the divine has been invited into this mind. And we are saying, divine, you do the preparation through my mind. You use my mind as your instrument. 2 seconds. A professor, a teacher is preparing for the next class. 2 seconds. The professor invites the divine into the preparation of that lesson plan or the class or the lecture. How long does it take to invite him? 2 seconds. Suppose we are going to the court to fight a great battle. A battle which is going to decide whether this home will be mine or it will be someone else's. Such a big battle, such an important battle. I'm preparing for that battle. I'm briefing the lawyer. Invite the divine. Invite the divine into your preparation. And then start the preparation. 2 seconds. How long does it take? And you offer the effort of briefing the lawyer, the effort of preparing for the case. But together with that, we offer the result that will accrue out of the case. What about the times when we are angry? And I'm really angry with someone. Someone has betrayed me. Someone has been false. What about those times when we are hurt? What about those times when we are having an argument with people? And this is the time to remember the verse of Isha Upanishad. The first verse of the Isha Upanishad says, Isha vasimidam sarvam yat kinch jagatyam jagat. All this belongs to the divine. My joy belongs to the divine. This means my joy belongs to the divine. When I feel very happy about something, before starting to enjoy that happiness, I close my eyes, I thank the divine, and in my Anjali, I offer it. I offer, in the Anjali, I offer the happiness to the divine. Now, I'm hurt. I'm really hurt. So if my joy and my happiness belongs to the divine, this hurt too doesn't belong to me. It belongs to him. So why am I living in this grief? Before experiencing the grief or after experiencing it for some time, I remember the divine and I take this grief in my Anjali and I say, I offer this grief to thee. O divine, it doesn't belong to me. Let thy will be done, not mine. And then invite him into the way of dealing with that grief, dealing with that anger, dealing with that hurt in everything. We must learn how to invite the divine, offer it to him and invite him. So he actually uses us as his instrument to deal with that stress. You know, this important mantra, important verse of the Gita, karmanyevadhikaraste ma phaleshu kadachan. Now, often people misinterpret it. And often people say, this mantra, this verse from the Gita is saying very clearly that we should not desire to win. We should not desire the fruit. We should not think about the fruit of our effort. But they have completely misinterpreted it. If we do not think about the fruit of our effort, how will we be motivated to make that effort? To make that effort, we need to be motivated. What will motivate us? The result will motivate us. So we have to keep the result in front of us. What are the words that Sri Krishna has used? He has said, karmanyevadhikaraste adhikar. He says, you do not have an adhikar over the fruit and the result. But we do not have any control on it. And we do not have any adhikar on the result. But if we don't even desire a positive result, how will we be motivated to work? We have to have a motivation to work. But the work must be offered to the divine. The effort that we are putting in must be offered to the divine. The motivation to work, the result, must be offered to the divine. Because the result, we have no adhikar on it. But we can have a desire for it. And we offer the desire to the divine and say, let thy will be done, not mine. I'm working for this result. My desire is to win. I'm working towards it. But I offer the result to thee. Let thy will be done. And whatever we are doing, from the most mundane thing, we are going in for a shower. Now imagine that Shakti herself has become that water. And we offer the shower, the water to the divine. We say, you are this water. Suffuse me with your energy. Make me just like you. Fill me with yourself. our water, our food, our conversations with people, our arguments with people, the ones who we love, the ones who we don't love, all this must be offered to the divine. And he should be invited into our relationships. So all our relationships can become more and more and more divine. Now Sri Aurobindo, while interpreting this very important verse of chapter 9, verse 27, he says, and this is a quotation from Essays on the Gita by Sri Aurobindo. By far, Essays on the Gita is the most authentic and most beautiful interpretation of the Bhagavad Gita. So I quote from it, page 568, make of all you do, from the greatest and most unusual effort to the smallest daily act, make of each act of your mind, each act of your heart, each act of your body, of every inner and outer turn, of every thought and will and feeling, of every step and pause and movement, a sacrifice to the master of all sacrifice and tapasya. We can make it an offering to the master of all sacrifice and tapasya. And we have to offer what? We have only three coverings to the soul, as I said in the beginning of the session. We have a physical being, that which in Indian philosophy is called the Annamaya. So we have this body by which we act. So every act has to be offered in an anjali to the divine. Then we have an emotional being, what is called Pranamaya. So every emotion, every feeling, har bhav, jo bhi bhav aata hai, prem ka bhav aaye, chahe uska opposite aaye, chahe joy ki feeling ho rahi hai, chahe grief ki feeling ho rahi hai. Whatever feeling we are feeling, whatever emotion we have to make an offering of it. What then? The third is the power to think, the cognitive power. So every thought that comes to the mind, every idea, all of it has to be offered to the divine. This is the greatest secret and the bottom line of the Bhagavad Gita, of how to connect with him. And how long does it take, my dear students? Barely 2 seconds. And in those 2 seconds, you have not only offered what you are thinking, feeling, or doing, you have also invited him into that act. Tell me, will we alone be able to do the work better, or once we have invited him into the action, invited him into the thought, invited him into the feeling? And you know what? And this is another very great secret that I would like to reveal to you. The divine has promised that he will come every single time that we call him. And when he comes, every time that he comes, he touches us and goes. He actually touches us and goes. As we become subtler and subtler and subtler in whatever we are doing, as we become closer and closer and closer to him and start experiencing him, we will experience that touch. We will experience the divine touch each and every time. What a beautiful promise the divine has given to us. Now, let me share with you a conversation between Uddhava and Krishna after the Mahabharata war was over. Because this will bring more palpably to us why Krishna is saying, call me, invite me, offer to me. Call me, invite me, and offer to me. Call me, invite me in all that you do, and offer to me. Once, Uddhava asked Sri Krishna, why he didn't come to help Yudhishthira when he was playing the dice with Shakuni? And you know what Krishna said to Uddhava? Krishna said, Yudhishthira didn't call me. He didn't even tell me that he had accepted to play dice with Duryodhana. Uddhav said, even if Yudhishthira didn't invite you, Krishna, you could have still gone to the palace and you could have turned the luck in favor of Yudhishthira, or you could have at least stopped him from betting on his brothers, or at least you could have stopped Yudhishthira, Dharmaraj betting his own wife, Draupadi. And you know what Krishna replied? Krishna said, Yudhishthira had prayed that I don't come to the hall. Yudhishthira had prayed that I don't even come to know that he was compelled to play the game. I was tied by his prayers. When we pray to him, he gets tied by our prayers. Until Draupadi kept trying to save herself from being disrobed, Krishna did not come. Till she kept pleading to the elders there, Bhishma Pitama, Guru Drona, Dhritarashtra, Krishna didn't come to help her. Until she tried to hold on to her sari and save herself, Krishna did not come. But the moment Draupadi called for Krishna, that very moment, he came as an answer to her call. Hey Krishna, hey Krishna, hey Krishna. That is the whole point of offering, that we remember him, that we invoke him into our thoughts, into our emotions, into our actions. They may be good thoughts. Sometimes they may be bad thoughts. Sometimes they may even be ugly thoughts. It doesn't matter. What matters is, in the ultimate analysis, what really matters is, have we remembered him all the while? Have we invited him into our actions? I'm sure each one of us can pull out those two seconds in whatever we are doing and invite him over. All of us can do that. Uddhav then asked Krishna, what does it mean, Krishna, that you will only come when you are called? Will you not come on your own to help people in crisis, to establish justice in the world? Krishna smiled. He said, no, Uddhava. Everyone's life proceeds based on their karma. I don't run it. I don't interfere in everybody's life. I am only a silent witness, sitting within them, standing close to them. This is my dharma. This is the law of the universe. Buddha was very shocked and he was actually angry. He said, wow, very good, Krishna. In that case, you will stand close to us. You will observe all our evil acts. As we keep committing more and more sins, you want us to commit more blunders, accumulate sins. You want us to suffer, asked Uddhava. And you know what Krishna said? Krishna said, Uddhava, my dear friend, please realize the deeper meaning of your own statements. When you understand, when you realize that I am standing as a witness inside you, that I am standing as a witness right next to you, how can you do anything wrong? You definitely cannot do anything wrong. The problem is that you forget. You forget that I am present within you. You forget that I am present all around you. You forget that I'm present right next to you. You forget that I am Lord and Master of all that you are doing. And you think that you can do things without my knowledge. That is when you get into trouble. Dharmaraj's ignorance was that he thought he can play the game of dice and I will not know. He thought that he didn't need to invite me into the game. Into the act of gambling. He did not invite me into the results. If he had invited me into the result, if he had invited me into the gamble, the Pandavas would not have suffered the way they did. So my dear students, ponder over this story. Ponder over Sri Krishna's words. What do we learn from this story? What do we learn from Sri Krishna's words? We learn that we must remember him at all times. In the smallest acts, in the most mundane acts, in the most important acts, that the divine is palpably there within us, around us, and above us. All we need to do is offer to him the work that we are doing. All we need to do is remember him, remember the work that we are doing, and offer it in our anjali to the divine, and invite him into the process. Just keep inviting the divine into the process of the work that you are doing, into the result that will accrue out of the work that you are doing. All we need to do is invite him and offer to him. And the mother of Sri Aurobindo Ashram says, it's a very beautiful quotation from the mother, when one enters consciously into contact with one's soul and the union is established, it can no longer be undone. It is something permanent, constant, which resists everything, the mother. Let's read this quotation again. When we enter consciously into contact with our soul, and when the union is established, that union can no longer be undone. It becomes permanent, constant, and it resists everything. When we get stationed in the soul, when one gets stationed in the soul, when one gets stationed in the soul, he becomes the feather blown by the breath of the Lord. When one gets stationed in the soul, he becomes the flute on the lips of the divine. When stationed in the soul, he becomes the perfect instrument of the Lord. Let us just for 30 seconds meditate on becoming the flute on which the divine plays his divine music. All that we say, all that we think, all that we feel, all that we do, let it be played by the divine. Let him use me as his perfect instrument. May I become the perfect instrument who is used by the divine for his work. 30 seconds, let us meditate on this thought. Thank you, my dear students. Thank you. Thank you. So we have 10 more minutes for any question and answers.
Anjali ji, main Dr. Bhargav hoon.
Namaskar, Dr. Thank you.
Agar aap chahenge to main kuch puch sakta hoon.
Bilkul, Doctor. Absolutely. Bole, Doctor.
Pehli cheez to ye hai, Anjali ji, ki maine aapka ye discourse bahut enjoy kiya. बहुत ही सुंदर था क्योंकि ये बहुत सिंपल था. मेरा प्रश्न ये है कि ब्रह्म ज्ञान को ब्रह्म दृष्टि में कन्वर्ट करने में समय लगता है और दिक्कतें होती हैं, तो उसमें जो आपने आज कहा वो तो बहुत ही सिंपल बना दिया कि अगर हम हमेशा ये याद करें कि हर चीज़ ब्रह्म के लिए है जो हमारे अंदर ही निवास करता है. तो इसके अलावा
हाँ जी,
कहना चाहेंगे कि किस तरह से हम ब्रह्म ज्ञान को ब्रह्म दृष्टि में और कन्वर्ट कर सकते हैं.
एक्चुअली क्या होता है डॉक्टर जी, हम लोग जब बहुत डिफिकल्ट टर्म्स को पकड़ लेते हैं तो वो टर्म्स हमको काफी बौखला देते हैं. बट उन टर्म्स को ना देखें, बस हम ईश्वर की प्रेजेंस को देखें, उनके सामीप्य को देखें कि वो हमारे कितने समीप हैं. और उनके सामीप्य का जब हम दर्शन करते रहे, एक्सपीरियंस करने की कोशिश करें, जब हम इनवाइट करते हैं तो वो होते हैं, इस बात का विश्वास हो जाए. फिर वो दृष्टि कैसे कैसे दृष्टि में वो हमें गोचर होने लग जाएंगे, हर जगह एक्सपीरियंस होने लगेगा. जल भी पिएंगे तो जल में लगेगा कि मैं आपको ये आई एम ड्रिंकिंग यू. तो ये धीरे धीरे अपने आप स्वतः होएगा. बट उसमें बहुत ज्यादा इतना विचार उसके ऊपर डालने की जगह एक्सपीरियंस पे जाएंगे तो एक्सपीरियंस का माध्यम इज मच स्ट्रॉन्गर देन द विचार का माध्यम, क्योंकि एक्सपीरियंस का माध्यम यहाँ से एमिट होता है फ्रॉम द सोल, और विचार माइंड से होता है. माइंड बहुत लिमिटेड स्पीयर है, इट्स अ वेरी, आर माइंड, आर इमोशंस, आर फिजिकल, आर ऑल वेरी लिमिटेड. इन द नेक्स्ट एंड द नेक्स्ट व्हेन वी टॉक अबाउट द एम ऑफ लाइफ वी विल अंडरस्टैंड मोर अबाउट दिस, कि कैसे हम इन सबको और सूक्ष्म करते चले जाएं.
तो क्या हम भक्ति योग का पे ज्यादा प्रधानता दे रहे हैं इस समय?
यस, आई मीन कृष्णा ने खुद कहा है गीता में, जब उन्होंने चार भक्तों के बारे में बताया, बोले चारों भक्त मुझे बहुत प्रिय है. वो जो आर्द्र है, जो बहुत तकलीफ में, जो बहुत सफर कर रहा है, और मेरे पास खाली अपनी तकलीफ को एलिविएट करने मेरे पास आ रहा है, पर वो मेरे को बहुत प्रिय है. क्यों प्रिय है? क्योंकि आ तो मेरे पास ही रहा है ना, इसलिए कृष्णा कहते हैं आर्द्र भक्त मेरे को बहुत प्रिय है. देन ही सेज अर्थार्थी. अब नाउ वन वंडर्स कि जो भक्त उनके पास आ रहा है खाली अर्थ के लिए, कि लेट मी बिकम रिचर, लेट मी गेट मोर, वो भी भगवान को बहुत प्रिय है. तो मैं किरीट जोशी जी, मेरे टीचर को हमेशा पूछती थी, मेरे गाइड, मेरे गुरु, कि अर्थार्थी क्यों बोला कृष्ण ने? बोले अर्थ उसको चाहिए, ही रिकॉग्नाइजेस हिज डिजायर, बट आता तो कृष्ण के पास है, आता तो ईश्वर अल्लाह क्राइस्ट के पास ही है ना, इसलिए श्री कृष्ण ने कहा वो मेरे को बहुत प्रिय है. फिर तीसरा उन्होंने बोला जिज्ञासु, कि जो जानना चाहता है, ही वॉन्ट्स टू अंडरस्टैंड दिस स्पिरिचुअल नॉलेज, बट फॉर द सेक ऑफ सेटिस्फाइंग हिज माइंड, नॉट फॉर एनीथिंग एल्स, वो भी मुझे बहुत प्रिय है. बट इन द एंड ही सेज, जो ज्ञानी है, जो जानता है कि मैं उसके करीब सामीप्य हूँ, मैं उसके समीप हूँ, मैं उसके चारों तरफ हूँ, जो जानता है और मेरे साथ हर समय कम्युनिकेशन में है, जो मुझे प्यार करता है मेरे लिए, नॉट फॉर अर्थ, नॉट फॉर डिफिकल्टीज, नॉट फॉर ज्ञान, जस्ट लव्स मी फॉर मी, वो मेरे को सबसे ज्यादा प्रिय है. आपने खुद जवाब दे दिया डॉक्टर, कि जो ज्ञानी है, जो भक्त है, वो सबसे प्रिय है ईश्वर को.
थैंक यू सो मच.
एनीबडी एल्स?
मैम, प्रतीक्षा हैज अ क्वेश्चन ऑन चैट. प्रतीक्षा इज अ स्टूडेंट, शी हैज आस्क्ड हाउ टू कंट्रोल द फीलिंग ऑफ सेपरेशन वी फील व्हेन वी लूज समवन क्लोज टू अस, लाइक इफ डेथ डू अस अपार्ट फ्रॉम आवर मदर, फादर, सिस्टर और ब्रदर. How would we control this feeling to be normal in life?
There is only one answer to all these questions. The divine is so close to us that we have to call out to him. What has helped me in my life, in all my problems? In the beginning, I mean from 1991, I must have written hundreds of letters to the divine. When we write to him, it's not that it's going on empty ears. He hears, he reads, and he answers in his own subtle manner. So writing letters to the divine would really, really help. And another thing that helps in when a very close somebody departs is to remember that while that person was around us, we always enjoyed that person's presence for ourselves. But now that person needs my help because he is going through a very difficult transition. When one leaves the physical world, the soul goes through a difficult journey because it carries the baggage, our unfulfilled desires, our unfulfilled ideas, all that baggage the soul has to carry. And it moves through a very difficult transition through the vital world and through the mental world. And at that time, he needs protection. The soul needs protection. And the person who is missing the person for oneself, instead of that, one extends oneself and covers the soul with any mantra that person believes in. It can be just a simple om, but covering the soul with a mantra would help the soul in this transition of the soul. And when we are working to help the soul in its transition, our grief starts getting dissipated. This is one experience that I have.
Ma'am, to add to her question only, I'm adding my question. So when somebody very near to us leaves this worldly affair, So we naturally we cry and we miss that person a lot. So are we not doing it correct, like when we miss and we cry? So should we be doing this, or what is the correct way to handle such situations in our own lives?
So Sri Aurobindo has given an answer to this. He says to grieve is normal. One will grieve because one has lived in the physical, emotional, vital, mental space for all our life. And we must give grief its due, but it should not be carried on for too long. Some people are not able to get out of that circle of grief, and then you give grief its due, but for some time. And then slowly and steadily start working on trying to protect, trying to give some kind of a protection to the soul which has departed. And when your focus moves from the grief I am having to the protection I would like to give to the soul which has departed, the grief starts getting dissipated. There is nothing wrong in grieving, but the grief must be for a certain span of time. It should not be pulled endlessly. Otherwise, then we open ourselves to negative forces. Someday, maybe in the next two sessions, I don't know, I haven't decided about those next two sessions, but we must think about the negative forces. We must think about the positive forces and how we open ourselves to negativity. So we have to be very careful about that. Always to be in a positive, you know, kind of a Suraksha Chakra hona chahiye.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Ma'am, we have a question from Shalini Sinha, ma'am. Why yes. does Sri Aurobindo say that we should offer everything as a sacrifice?
That is why when I was reading out his quotation, that you can very easily substitute sacrifice for offering. Offering and sacrifice can easily be substituted. When he used the word sacrifice, we can think that he said sacrifice because getting into another mode which we are not used to. So it is sacrificing my own, you know, a certain kind of a comfort zone. We start getting comfortable in our grief also. And then to be able to give up the grief, ye grief mere ko nahi, I am offering it to you, it belongs to you. We start getting comfortable in our happiness, in our joy, and we just want to revel in it. But if we have learned the spirit of offering, we have learned the art of offering, we have learned the science of offering, then our life becomes more beautiful. It is something so simple. The whole beauty is that it is the simplest method to connect with the divine. There is no mumbo jumbo that is needed. We don't have to read a lot. There is a very beautiful, I hope I remember the verse. Mundaka Upanishad.
Nayamatma pravachanena labhyo na medhaya na bahuna shrutena. Yame vesha vrinute tena labhyas tasyaisha atma vivrinute tanum swam.
Neither can the soul be realized by attending many discourses, nor by intellectual prowess, nor by reading and listening to the Vedic scriptures. The soul will reveal itself only to the one who has a focused, single-pointed aspiration to experience and realize it.
Neither by your intelligence nor by listening to too much. What will really bring you closest to the Atma is when your burning aspiration, that one aspiration of life, is to become closer and closer and closer to the soul within. And that is your one and only burning aspiration. Then you don't need to listen to anything. You need to just focus on that one burning aspiration. Because the soul's aspiration is also the same. The soul is aspiring to let the light come out through our body, through our vital being, through our mind. The soul is also aspiring for that. That is a very law, the nature of the soul, right? But to connect the outer to the inner, we need to do this. It's like an SMS that you're sending to the friend inside to connect. How do you connect? Otherwise, we get lost in the lesson plan we are making. I get lost in the fight I'm having. I get lost in what is happening to me in the world. I'm being hurt. I don't like it the way it's at, so-and-so is treating me. I get lost in all that. But if I get into the habit that so-and-so is hurting me, I pick up that hurt in an anjali and I pour it to the divine. What have I done? Ek dhaga hamare se uske andar band gaya. From where he can now transmit what he wants to transmit to me. But that call has to be from me, from my outer me to the inner me. You can call it a sacrifice. You can call it an offering. But wo dhaage bante jane chahiye from inside, from outside to the inner being, to the divine.
Our student Vaktavar has asked a question that my mind makes me confused. It demands for proof. Give me a proof of existence of soul and like you can understand it.
Okay, so, understood. So Bhaktavar, I tell you that, are you know what? You know, it has just come out of the blue and watching it. This glass just came of its own. No, ma'am. Somebody has devised how to make glass, how to form it in this shape. The pen I'm using, can it just come out of the blue? Somebody has devised it. And then this beautiful laptop that you're using, the iPad you're using, can it just come out of the blue? Then what about this beautiful universe? The planets, they're all going on their own orbit. Not one planet, not even one planet moves out of its orbit. Not one planet goes outside its law. Somebody must have created it. When you get hurt and a little blood oozes out of you, what is it that makes the blood system flow with the white blood cells? And there you are, this is healed. Who could have created this beautiful circulatory system inside me? That the blood, I take in oxygen and it suffuses my blood system and then it goes and gives oxygen in seconds. My stomach, all the organs, my brain, complex. You need more proof of the existence of God? Think about it. Really, Bhaktavar, think about it. Do we need more proof for the existence of God? Does summer sometimes by chance come in the winters? Or winter come instead of the rains? Who could it be who has made such a beautiful plan? And then he has let this plan be manifested so beautifully. I don't know if I've answered your question, Vaktavar.
Vaktavar may say so. Vaktavar, you have to say anything, you can directly ask.
Yes, ma'am. Mostly I am just, you gave me answer properly, but something I also need to be searched in myself and then I will be more clarified, ma'am. But your answer is really going to help me a lot, ma'am. Definitely.
Thank you, Vaktavar. Mona ma'am, I don't know if we'll have time today. Otherwise, at least put in the link of that beautiful rendition of the poem Who by Sri Aurobindo. Sri Aurobindo has written a beautiful poem. He's written many beautiful poems. But Who is a beautiful poem. Mona ma'am will just post the link and you can copy it, Vaktavar. And everybody can listen to it. It's very beautiful. Mitali ma'am wanted to say something. Anybody
yes,
else?
Ma'am. Sri Krishna. Jai Sri Krishna, ma'am.
Jai Sri Krishna.
And thank you for that beautiful session, ma'am. I just wanted to, share my experience because I've been attending your sessions and I know that this offering thing is doing a magic to it is not only, because this is something which I have practiced, which I am practicing, not only, starting every work before starting anything, when the day begins, I offer my day and I have given, my entire family is doing that.
Oh.
And I've seen that change, ma'am, because initially we used to feel everything is like a kind of problem which comes. And you don't know how to deal with that problem. When we have started offering these things, life has become very simple because we have developed that trust that yes. let thy will be done. Beautiful. You know, everything will be done. And my daughters, my husband, everybody is doing the same thing.
They oh, I'm so happy to hear this.
Yes, ma'am. My both the daughters and my husband, all of us. And we are finding difference because our relationship has also improved a lot.
Beautiful. ईश्वर को आपने बुला लिया ना, अपने घर पे बुला लिया. एक जना बुलाए, तीन नहीं बुलाए तो फर्क पड़ता है. चारों बुला रहे हैं,
चारों बुला रहे
हैं. He has no choice but to make himself palpably experienced. And how do you experience the divine? If you have to define God in one word, that one word would be love. Yes. Right?
Yes, ma'am.
So, आपने बुलाया, हम दौड़े चले आए. और अपने साथ में क्या लाएंगे? Love and harmony.
Love and harmony.
So that is his definition.
Yes, ma'am.
How happy I am, Mitali.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
The actual
children are also I'm teaching Setama Jaipuria School only. I'm teaching there. My kids are also my small preschool children are also doing that.
Yes, this is something I'd like to tell about Mitali, ma'am, that she has started the playgroup in Jaipuria School, and what a wonderful playgroup we have. Children at such a young age, they love their environment, they love their grandparents, they love their parents, they do for their parents, and they have a chair. We have a chair in our playgroup, which is called the chair of perfection, in every classroom. And perfection means God. It's just another word for God. So instead of saying chair of God, we used to earlier call it chair of God. Now we call it chair of perfection. And everybody knows that God is sitting there. They experience the divine all the time in their classroom. And when they go back home, then they keep a chair of perfection at home as well.
Yes.
These 2.5-year-olds, they grow into this as they go into LKG and UKG. And this gets this method of offering becomes stabilized in them. So this is what we are doing in Jaipuria School.
An invisible friend, ma'am. Always present.
Thank you
so much, ma'am.
Thank you so much.
Sanket has asked, I don't always feel like I am in tune with my emotions or those of others. Can mindfulness help me?
Mindfulness will help in any case, in any circumstance. Mindful of what? Mindful of the presence of the divine. So, first of all, we have to become mindful of the presence of the divine, which may take time. So, we start with the mechanical process. The mechanical process is, in the beginning, it is mechanical. That whatever I'm thinking, whatever I'm feeling, whatever I'm doing, I'm offering it. Pehle ekdam mechanical hoga. Khana samne aaya, I offer to you. There's no emotion joined to it, but it's okay. Because mechanically karte 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 dhaga humne baar baar bandha pehle bina koi emotion ke bandha par wo dheere dheere wo dhaga actually band jata hai. So to become mindful, what was his name, the student's name?
Sanket, ma'am.
Sanket, jab aap roz baar baar dhaga bandhenge, phir wo ek din aapke andar mindfulness kyon aa jayegi? क्योंकि आप धागा माइंडफुलनेस के साथ ही बांध रहे हैं. ही व्हाट इज द डिवाइन, व्हाट इज गॉड? गॉड इज सत चित आनंद. सत, आई रिपीट, वी डिड इट इन द फर्स्ट सेशन, सत इज दैट व्हिच एग्जिस्ट्स, व्हिच इज द सेल्फ एग्जिस्टेंट. चित इज कॉन्शियसनेस, इन अदर वर्ड्स चित इज माइंडफुलनेस. और जहां पे एग्जिस्टेंस एंड कॉन्शियसनेस संग में होंगे वहां आनंद होएगा ही होएगा. अब आप सोचो, आप आग में हाथ डालोगे तो आपका हाथ क्या होगा? What will happen to your hand? It will get burnt. Now if you continuously dip into ananda, तो आपके अंदर आनंद का तो you are dipping into the स्रोत, into the beginning, into the origin of ananda. You will be suffused with ananda. You are dipping into consciousness. Chit, chit shakti. It's not only chit, but it is chit mindfulness with a force of manifestation. So if you keep connecting with mindfulness, awareness, which is God Himself, by offering your outer things, you cannot stop doing your outer work. Krishna told Arjuna that not even for 1 minute can you be actionless. There are people who say, "Humne sab kuch hi sab, maine jeevan ko tyag diya hai." Kya tyag diya? Aap khana khaye bina reh sakte? And this Sri Krishna tells Arjuna, can you stay without food? That's an action. Can you stay without sleeping? Can you stay without drinking water? All these things you have to do, but you have to bring everything, mindfulness, awareness, into whatever you are doing. Very beautiful question.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Ma'am, thank you so much. I know thank you is too mild a word, because whatever we experience is beyond words, ma'am. Thank you so much. अन्वेषक की तरह मैं एक चीज पूछना चाह रही हूँ मैम कि हम जो स्टेट सच्चिदानंद की जो स्थिति रहती है, जो ब्लिस की स्थिति रहती है, कभी कभी हम एक बच्चे को स्माइल करते हुए देखते हैं तब हम पहुंचते हैं उस स्थिति में, या कोई बुजुर्ग या कोई ऐसा व्यक्ति हमें सिर पर हाथ रख दे या कोई हमको सिर्फ ब्लेस कर दे तब हम वो फील करते हैं मैम, आप अभी बोल रही हैं वो फील करते हैं हम मैम, तो क्या ये सारी स्थितियों में वो हमारे साथ हैं जो आप कहते हैं ना, वो आते हैं, वो बुला तो उनको हमने बुलाया तो हम, मतलब आई नो इट्स वेरी डिफिकल्ट, आई एम फाइंडिंग इट वेरी डिफिकल्ट एक्सप्रेस इन वर्ड्स मैम, कि उनकी उनकी अनुभूति, उनकी उनके एहसास को क्या हम इन मोमेंट्स में कि हाँ वो हमारे पास है, ये सारे मोमेंट्स होते हैं क्या मैम?
देखिए वो तो आपके पास हमेशा है, पर हमें उनकी अनुभूति नहीं होती. क्यों नहीं होती? क्योंकि हम उन्हें याद ही नहीं करते. हम इतने व्यस्त रहते हैं बाहर की लाइफ में कि हम उन्हें याद नहीं करते. जब याद नहीं करते तो उनकी हमें अनुभूति नहीं होती, क्योंकि अनुभूति का जो स्पेस है वो तो पूरा भरा हुआ है इन माय आउटर वर्क. अब आउटर वर्क तो बंद नहीं होने वाला है ना, आउटर वर्क विल कंटिन्यू बिकॉज हमें जीवन जीना है. बट आउटर वर्क को उनके साथ कनेक्ट करेंगे तब कभी कभी अनुभूति होगी. क्या होता है, ये जो एक्सपीरियंस ऑफ द डिवाइन है, आपने बहुत सुंदर से कहा कि जब हम एक छोटे से बच्चे की स्माइल देखते हैं तो मुझे लगता है जैसे मुझे उसकी अनुभूति हुई. जैसे कोई बड़े ने, जिसको मैं बहुत रिस्पेक्ट करती हूँ, बहुत लव करती हूँ, उन्होंने अपना हाथ मेरे सर पे रखा, मुझे लगता है जैसे मुझे ईश्वर की अनुभूति हुई. वेरी ब्यूटिफुल. धीरे 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 ये एक्सपीरियंसेस बढ़ेंगे. अब एक्सपीरियंसेस में भी क्या होता है, they come and they go, they come and they go. What is the purpose of our life? The purpose of our life is ki hum experience mein hi khali na rahe, hum station ho jaye. I get stationed here. Hum jo bhi kare, even when somebody is shouting at me, being unjust to me, main yahan station hu. Jab yahan station honge to uski baaton ka hamare upar asar hi nahi hoga. क्यों असर नहीं होगा? क्योंकि हम आनंद स्वरूप तालाब में, झील में पूरे के पूरे भीगे हुए. उस आनंद में भीगे हुए को जो कुछ भी बाहर से मिलता है वो आनंद के थ्रू, इट हैज टू गो थ्रू देन एंटर इनटू अस एंड देन वी आर एबल टू सी इट एज अ मेथोडोलॉजी बाय विच हम और परफेक्ट होंगे. तो ये एक दिन का मामला नहीं है, ये जन्मों 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 का मामला है. और जन्मों तक ये करते रहना है कि बस हम उनका उनकी प्रेजेंस के बारे में याद करें. और उसी का सिंपलेस्ट तरीका श्री कृष्ण ने दिया है गीता में, उसको करती रहिए मनीषा मैम, आप देखेंगे जादू. उनको पत्र लिखना शुरू कर दीजिए, आई एम श्योर आप लिखती होंगी. और पत्र लिखिए, उनको पत्र बड़े पसंद है. जस्ट कीप अ डायरी इन which is your personal diary, your personal communication, your beloved. He is our beloved. He is a lover who will never fail us. Aur unko chitthi, 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 likhte chale jaiye. Aur dekhiye kaise kaise magic hota jata hai aapke jeevan mein.
Ma'am, thank you so much. I would like to share, ma'am. Roj raat ko sone ke pehle main aapki recording sun rahi hoon. फर्स्ट सेशन की मैम, इट इज एक्चुअली कि मैं एक ऐसे जर्नी में हम लोग सब लोग स्टार्ट करें
The journey is beautiful, ma'am. Not thinking about the destination. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Ma'am, should we play the poem? Please play the poem.
In the blue of the sky, in the green of the forest, whose is the hand that has painted the glow? When the winds were asleep in the womb of the ether, who was it roused them and bade them to blow? He's lost in the heart, in the cavern of nature. He's found in the brain, where he builds up the thought. In the pattern and bloom of the flowers he's woven, in the luminous net of the stars he's caught. In the strength of a man, in the beauty of woman, in the laugh of a boy, in the blush of a girl. The hand that sent Jupiter spinning through heaven spends all its cunning to fashion a girl. These are his works and his veils and his shadows. But where is he then? By what name is he known? Is he Brahma or Vishnu? A man? Or a woman, bodied or bodiless, twin or alone. We have love for a boy who is dark and resplendent. A woman is lord of us, naked and fierce. We have seen him a muse on the snow of the mountains. We have watched him at work in the heart of the spheres. We will tell the whole world of his ways and his cunning. He has rapture of torture and passion and pain. He delights in our sorrow and drives us to weeping, then lures with his joy and his beauty again. All music is only the sound of his laughter, all beauty, the smile of his passionate bliss. Our lives are his heartbeats, our rapture the bridal of Radha and Krishna, our love is their kiss. His strength that is loud in the blare of the trumpets, and he rides in the car and he strikes in the spears. He slays without stint and is full of compassion. He wars for the world and its ultimate years. In the sweep of the worlds, in the surge of the ages, ineffable, mighty, majestic and pure, beyond the last pinnacle seized by the thinker, he is throned in his seat that forever endure. The master of man and his infinite lover, he is close to our hearts, had we vision to see. We are blind with our pride and the pomp of our passions. We are bound in our thoughts where we hold ourselves free. It is he in the sun who is ageless and deathless, and into the midnight his shadow is thrown. When darkness was blind and engulfed within darkness, he was seated within it. Immense.
Thank you. Before we end, let us just do a 10-15 second of silence and gratitude to the divine. Okay, we meet next Saturday. So yes. The third question is, what is the benefit of this path? We will discuss that. And maybe, what is the benefit of this path? And the fourth question, what is the aim of life? Maybe they both get merged in one, maybe. I haven't thought about that now. I'm going to start from now. So if they get merged in one, the fourth session will become meditation and concentration. What is the difference between meditation and concentration?
Thank you, ma'am, and all the esteemed guests who have joined, and all for joining us in the session and making it more effective through your overwhelming presence. And thank you so much, ma'am. I feel that listening to you each day, we are taking a step towards self-healing. I would also like to extend my sincere thanks to our director, Prithvi sir, for being so supportive in this journey, and all the faculty members and the staffs. And we shall connect with you all in the next session of the series. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Joyita. Thank you. Bye.